name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May the God of love and life, the God who comforts us in our afflictions, so that we can comfort others in theirs, may this God be with you always.
And with your spirit.
In the waters of baptism, Mary Clare died with Christ and rose with him to new life. Now the day of Christ's coming, may she be clothed with glory.
Reading from the book of Psalms. The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I lack. In green pastures he makes me lie down. To still waters he leads me. He restores my soul. He guides me along the right paths for the sake of his name. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadows of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff comfort me. You set a table before me in front of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overfills. Indeed, goodness and mercy will pursue me all of the days of my life. I will dwell in the house of the Lord for endless days.
The second reading is a reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. We do speak of wisdom in those who are mature, but not of wisdom of this age, nor the rulers of this age who are passing away. Rather, we speak God's wisdom, mysterious, hidden, which God predetermined before the ages of our glory, and which none of the rulers of this age knew. For if they had known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what eye has not seen and ear has not heard, and what has not entered the human heart, what God has prepared for those who love him, this God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit scrutinizes everything, even the depths of God, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
stand out for a reading from the Gospel. Shepherd, I shall not be in want. First verse of the first reading that you heard a few moments ago, Psalm 23, after which we sang a musical version of that same psalm, one of the hundreds that are available in these modern era. The family selected the readings that you heard and the music that we're singing for our prayer and reflection as we say our farewell this morning to Mary Clare, loving mother, beloved grandmother, sister and aunt, friend, neighbor, disciple of Jesus. And this family of faith here at Immaculate Conception expresses our profound sympathy to you and the loss of your mother, and to your family, to her son by marriage, Marco, her beloved grandchildren, Elijah and Kayla. Mary Clare was born in Minneapolis, the second of four children born to Patrick and Olivia, and our sympathy to you, Patrick, John, and Kathy, on the loss of your sister, and to your families, to her sisters by marriage, and to her nieces, and to her nephews and cousins. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. Words from the musical version that we sang a few moments ago. Surely the words of Psalm 23 are among the best known of the words, best loved of the words of Scripture. You know, people may not hold up signs at sporting events that say Psalm 23 like they do John 3:15. And yet, I would bet that with a little prompting, all of you here could recite by heart the words of that entire psalm. It's a short poem, perhaps 100 words in English, only 15 lines of poetry. They are among the most profound words in all of Scripture. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. People often find comfort in these words in times of danger, in times of loss, in times of grief. The psalm is often recited at the bedsides of those who are dying. And it is used often at wakes, almost invariably at funerals. Family and friends comfort one another with the words of this ancient poem. Isn't it that this short poem, written so many years ago, 1,000 years before the birth of Jesus, would have the ability to still speak to us, that could still comfort us living in this modern, unrelentingly scientific, and thoroughly urban culture. You know, the task of the shepherd then, as now, was difficult and lonely. He, or nowadays also she, led the flock to find pasture and water. The shepherd protected them from ravaging wild beasts and the weather. The sheep recognized the shepherd's voice, followed and trusted where he led. The shepherd quite literally was often the difference between life and death for his flock. Now, can you imagine in your mind's eye an ancient shepherd, perhaps even King David himself, standing there on a winter's evening, looking at the million stars in the skies above, overwhelmed by the stillness and the magnificence of it all. And suddenly, he realizes that what he is to his flock of sheep, God is to him. And under the inspiration of the white-hot fire of the Spirit, he sings the words of the song that echoes down through the ages. In the exact middle of the song, he stops talking about God and starts talking to God. For you are with me. You prepare a table before me. You anoint my head with oil. And a few moments ago in the Gospel according to John, we heard the words of the Good Shepherd of John's Gospel. I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even in death. And a few moments after that, Lazarus does hear the word of the Good Shepherd and rises to life. But, you know, it wasn't resurrected life. Lazarus still had to die again. The believer now who hears the words of Jesus, those words of life, rise to new and resurrected life, life that is renewed constantly in the presence of the author of all life. The death and the resurrection of Jesus, what we call the Paschal mystery, what we celebrate around this altar, what we celebrate every Sunday, what we're celebrating now, is supposed to be the center of the lives of every disciple, from rebirth in those saving waters of baptism until it ends in the mind and the heart of God forever. What we do here we call Eucharist. It's a word that means thanksgiving. And around this altar we thank God for the gift of redemption in Jesus, of course. But we also thank God for all of the other gifts that we are given in this life. And at the end of our funeral liturgy today, we will call these gifts signs of God's love for us and of the fellowship with the saints that is ours in Christ Jesus. And so we thank God, first of all, for Mary's life, 70 years of it. Yes, she could have lived longer, should have lived longer, yet we gather to celebrate not the end of that life, but that it happened at all, and that we were part of it. At the time of death, we learn how important family is to each of us. They can indeed divide our grief, multiply our joy in happier times. We thank God then for the gift of Mary's 38 years of marriage. Family and marriage are among the very best gifts that God gives us, according to those biblical authors. We thank God then for Mary's 38 years of loving marriage to Ray and for the new life that he gave, that came into this world because of their love for each other. Ray died in 2010, separated in death for 12 years now. They are together again. Mary was born and raised in Minneapolis. She and her family were members of this parish. It was here that she was baptized, here that she received her first communion. Here she celebrated Eucharist around this altar with her brothers and sisters in faith and received from this altar the pledge that we are given of a life beyond this one, the body and blood of the one she believed to be her Lord and Savior. She graduated from this parish's grade school and then attended Regina High School, a Catholic high school for girls in South Minneapolis. And there she was a member of the Future Business Leaders of America and the Photography Club. You told me that she met Ray at the Minnesota State Fair. And it was an unusual story. He saw her in one of the booths that she was working there, but apparently they didn't make much contact until the following year. And during the year, great spent time practicing his pitching, so that when he returned to that booth that Mary was staffing, he could then win for her a lot of those stuffed animals. She must have seen something she liked, as did he. After Ray returned from serving in the armed forces of Vietnam, they married here at Immaculate Conception around this altar in 1973. Mary had attended a community college after graduation from high school. Perhaps there she got interested in bookkeeping and then worked in accounting for most of her life, assisting as CPA and at Subway. She and Ray made their home in Apple Valley until Ray's work with the U.S. Postal Service took him to California in 2008. Fortunately, Ray died 3 years later, and at that time, Mary moved to a retirement community in Arizona. And you told me that Mary's first love was her family, often visiting her daughter and grandchildren in Wyoming. She hosted many holiday gatherings at which she served wonderfully homemade treats. You said that she had the best laugh, a dry sense of humor, and perfect comedic timing. She was, and I quote her printed obituary, "She was the red-headed girl everyone loved and no one could forget." Of course, she wasn't adverse to having a good day at the casino. Now, I hope that meant that she won. She liked photography. She was an excellent seamstress. She made all the bridesmaid dresses at her daughter's wedding. You called her generous, loyal to her friends, doer, determined, capable, awesome, loving, kind. There was nothing she wouldn't take on. For example, she would do tax returns for her family and friends. And you said she was an expert at changing tires. How many flats could she have had? Mary had some medical challenges involving heart problems and COPD. Her death was sudden and unexpected. On June 13th, in her sleep, Mary received that divine call home. And falling asleep here, she awakened the eternity of God. "Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life." The profound words of Psalm 23 are so revered today still because they offer us a way of seeing the world that makes it less frightening. It teaches us how to deal with the loss of the people that we love that is inevitable in our lives. It helps us cope with the distress and the conflict that this world offers. And it helps us to recognize the presence of God at times and in places where we might think God is absent, or when we might be so distracted by our concerns that we overlook God's presence. And so those words of the psalm, and of course scripture in general, teaches us how to look at our world, to see it clearly, to live in it courageously, making it a better place for ourselves, for everyone. That's what disciples of Jesus are supposed to be doing. Scripture tells us that this world is not perfect, but there is this one important difference, that it is God's world. This is now one astounding difference, is that the Word of God written in Scriptures has become incarnate among us as a human being. And even when Jesus seems absent and silent, even when we experience the absence of God, the Good Shepherd is always present to us and always there protecting and guiding the sheep into the life that lasts forever. Jesus and the scripture teach us gratitude for the things that we do have, and most of all when we feel alone and at the mercy of the impersonal forces of fate in a hostile universe, we are given that priceless reassurance: "Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And so our prayer for Mary this morning comes from that ancient psalm. "Mary, may the Lord lead you through the valley of the shadow of death back into the light of life. And may you dwell in the house of the Lord forever. May you begin now that new and unimaginably more exciting journey into the mind and the heart of God for ages without end. smell of God's peace, let us stand and place our knees before God in humble prayer. In baptism, Mary Clare received the light of Christ. May God now scatter the darkness and lead her over the waters of death. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Mary was set at the table of the Lord with the bread of life. May God now welcome her to the table of God's children in heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For family members who have preceded us in death, especially Mary's husband Ray, her mother and father Olivia and Patrick, and mother and father-in-law Bernice and Nick, for her brothers-in-law Michael and Stephen, may the Lord grant them an eternal home. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the sick, especially those suffering from heart disease, may they know the healing presence of the Lord and the support of family and friends. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For caregivers, for doctors and nurses and medical personnel in our hospitals and nursing homes, God grant them courage, perseverance, and satisfaction in their important vocation. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Mary's many friends and neighbors and all who were good to her in this life, God reward them for their kindness. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us gathered here to worship in faith, one day may we be gathered together again in God's kingdom. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Gracious God, hear now all of the prayers that we place before you for Mary and for ourselves, and lead us safely home from this world to the kingdom, for you, the Son, and the Spirit reign in one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated as we now prepare to celebrate Eucharist. Brothers and sisters, please stand now and join together in the prayer that my sacrifice and yours will be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
As we help me present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Mary, we beseech your mercy that she who did not doubt her son to be a loving Savior may find in him merciful judge, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has gone, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy.
rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts to be brought to you for consecration, that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church under, with your servant Francis, our Pope and Bernard, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Mary, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she, who is united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. When from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you in the passing of this life, give kindness to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you our God as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, to whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Now let's greet one another with a sign of peace.
Love.
Thank you all for coming here today. Last year, when I talked to Mary, she had told me that she wanted to live to be 70, and she made it in an extra 5 or 6 months. I wrote down some notes from when I was a child. Mary was my younger sister, and I think this is pretty much it continued with John and Kathy, but I put down her likes, and the first thing that came to mind was tasty pizza. That was her one of her favorite foods, and I remember whenever she got money for babysitting and other chores, we would go down, split our money and whatever, and get A&W root beer by the gallon. And John told me too that he had done this with her. I know that as soon as she got some money, she started enjoying a lot of food places. I just remember her talking about the Nanking, Denopolis, and she liked to go to Las Vegas, and I think we did close to 30 trips with her, we just had a great time there, and she did win sometime. Ray did win more, but every tax season, we would come out there, and always in the last part of April. And, you know, she enjoyed going to the lakes with the family. Some of the most important times for Mary, let's start with the first one, was probably her wedding here with Ray, and then Anne's wedding, and her love of grandchildren. Along with her personal family goes the support for Ray in his battle with multiple myeloma. We got a chance to go down there several times and visit him and Mary at the various hospitals that he was in. And I think that was her most challenging time. I wrote down a list of things that were very important to her. One, graduating from Regina, and then getting her first job with Aunt Rosemary. Marrying Ray, the birth of Anne, Anne's wedding, and her grandchildren. And in the latter part of our calls with her over the years, it was always about how Kayla and Eli were doing. And then she had two great friends in her later life. And one was Barb, her casino friend, and Christmas and Thanksgiving, other holidays. And then Mina, who's a friend she was a realtor first, but then became her good friend too. And she lives near us in San Luis Obispo. And
July 1st, I received a text from Mina saying, I will never get over the pain of losing you. It will remain embedded deep in my heart till I reach the end of my journey here on earth. And that was intended for Ann, Eli, and Kayla. And another text that I got was, I just wanted to send you both our condolences for losing your sister, Mary. I have been very sad and upset over what happened. We considered Mary as a member of our family, the sister I never had. We will think of her often, miss her kind, sweet person that she was. And she says, see you later, Mary. So those are a few notes that it reminds me of Mary and her kindness and her love for some from people in her realm of things here. Thank you all for coming here and sharing with us, and my brother John and Kathy and I and our wives, Gail and Carol, are all appreciative of all your service and kindness. Thank you.
Lord God, whoso left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our sister Mary may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express our affection for her. May ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet her again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. And let us spend a moment in silence. Into your hands, Father, mercy, we commend our sister. sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for all the blessings that you bestowed upon her in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of the fellowship with the saints that is ours in Christ Jesus. Merciful Lord, turn toward us, listen to our prayers, open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our sister forever. We ask this through Christ's arm.
Amen.
The family invites you to lunch and to take place immediately downstairs in our hospitality room. You're also invited to join us at Fort Snelling, where she will be interred. We will not go there in procession, but die privately. Mass will be available for you downstairs. It's Assembly Area 6 that we're meeting in. We have to be there by 1:15. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord.
And let perpetual light shine upon her.
May she rest in peace.
Amen.
May her soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, to the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Amen.
Now let us take our sister to a place of rest.